the police involved in a mother-daughter relationship. What's going on here?
My problem was is I didn't want to handle everything. Everything was just being thrown at me, and I just didn't want it.
Okay, but if you're going to play big people games, you got to play by big people rules. Okay, and you weren't even speaking before the show this morning, right?
Because I don't know how to let go. I don't know how to stop. I don't know how to stop protecting her. But I'm the enemy.
You have made some mistakes in this last year. Failing to love your daughter is not one of them. And God bless you for that. And God bless you by standing by her. And you should thank her for that. Yeah. You should absolutely thank her for that. We've got to take a break. And then I'm going to tell these two what I think needs to happen to make this relationship more positive. It may surprise them. We'll be right back.
When I opened the box, there was also a letter that my daughter wrote.
With this letter, I bury you. Now that you're gone, my life is through. I should have done more to save your life, but now I'm suffering through pain and strife. As I bury you today, I need to let go, but I will always love you. That you must know.
Well, I'm back with Deborah and Miranda, and like a lot of teens and their parents, they don't always communicate as effectively as they need to. Now, you're saying she's characterizing this wrong. You don't just run off when you don't like what you hear.
I have before. The reason, you know, I leave is because, you know, I missed curfew one night a couple weeks ago, and I came home, and my mom and I sat on the back porch, and we talked about it. But then there was another night where I had come home in the afternoon, right when she got off work, and I had missed something important, and she started yelling and screaming at me, and so I left. I don't want to be in a situation where I'm getting yelled and screamed at, and I'm putting myself up to do it back.
I just have a lot of fear when it's almost 2 o'clock in the morning, and I don't know where she's at. I'm scared to death. I've lost my daughter enough, and I have fought with everything in me to get her back. With all that hard work and almost giving my last breath this whole past year, it's like she still won't talk to me. She talked to me all the time. She wrote me letters. She couldn't wait to see me until she comes home. And then she doesn't need me. She doesn't like even.
Like, I do talk to her, but, you know, she's there. She's there, you know, with me. So she sees what goes on with my life. So there's really not much to talk about. When I'm away, I can tell her everything that I did during the day and everything, how I felt. But when I'm at home, you know, I'm not going to talk, you know, page after page after page as if I was writing it, because she's there with me and she sees how I feel and she's by my side. I don't need to talk that much.
I think you have some real problems with self-esteem. I think it's hurt you what people have said about you. I think you didn't value yourself enough to begin with, or you wouldn't have allowed yourself to get in a situation where you wound up pregnant at 15. So you make a decision in the moment and you get pregnant, then you have a miscarriage, and you say, well, I didn't want the baby, so I didn't have the money or the ability to terminate the pregnancy, so I read that you could smoke, and sure enough, I had a miscarriage. Well, let me tell you, I've talked to the experts, and the likelihood that you're smoking, even as a non-smoker, for a short period of time in advance of this miscarriage, very likely had very little, if anything, to do with it, even remotely almost. Next thing we know, you're labeled baby killer and first-degree murder and all these horrific things. This takes a toll on someone. I think you are experiencing depression. I think you're experiencing anxiety, and I think there are elements of post-traumatic stress disorder here. I think this just keeps coming back and grabbing you by the throat and the heart, and I think you're contending with it the best you know how, but that's not, you don't have a lot of resources at your age to deal with that, and I think you need help with that. And I think you need a break from your mother. I think you two at one level have a wonderful relationship, and I want to preserve that long term. You're labeled in your community, and you're starting to label yourself in that way, and I want that to change. I think you should go away. I think you should go away to a school somewhere. And I've made arrangements to offer that to you, and I'm going to tell you, I'm not going to send you there. I'm going to tell you that I think it's an option you could consider, and if you want to do it, then I'm going to make it available to you. And if you don't want to do it, then I'm going to help you in your town where you are. So, I mean, it's totally up to you. Patty Evans is here. I mean, one of my favorite places in America is the Aspen Education Group. I think they have a wonderful residential school. And there's an intense therapy program there that helps you. And it lets you get a really fresh start. And if I were you, I wouldn't walk, I would run. And Patty's here. Hi, Patty. How are you?
Good.
Patty's here from the Aspen Education Group. They have the Copper Canyon Academy, which is an all-girls therapeutic boarding school. You can see pictures of it on screen here. It's fully accredited college preparatory school. They help heal things emotionally and physically, spiritually. There are lots of recreational opportunities with sports and equine therapy and choir and dance and yoga. I mean, it's a knockout home run. Y'all have a wonderful program there, Patty. How does that sound as I talk to you about it?
A lot to think about.
Yeah. But is it an option to you?
Yeah, it's an option.
You're in a grieving process. There's a lot going on with you. And you deserve this kind of a chance. You deserve this kind of an opportunity. But I won't do it to you. I will only do it with you. Would you support her doing something like
100%.
That? 100%. And I think you have been damaged in this process as well. And so I asked Miles Adcox to come here. He's the CEO of OnSight, which is a terrific program that we've worked with over the years. And it's an intensive therapeutic and personal growth program where you go and you spend, you know, just short periods of concentrated time to help you kind of take a deep breath and get back in touch with yourself. Miles, what do you want to say?
Deborah, first of all, you're not the only mother who has sat here in front of us and had this fear about losing their child. So I have a lot of empathy for you there. And I hear you say you want to let go, and that's really important to you. And letting go requires an internal shift. And I think that's why Dr. Phil suggests that, is so you don't focus more on this external thing. We're going to take you somewhere, let you focus on your part, and really let you take a break, take a breather, and look at where we go from here.
It's time to be selfish and put yourself at the top of the list and let these very loving and nurturing people kind of help you get a fresh start. These are things I think you need to do, because I've told you I think there's a lot going on with you. If you choose not to do that, then I'm going to do the best I can to make resources available to you to help manage some of this at home. But it's not okay where it is. You've got to get closure on some of these things, and don't let this define the rest of your life. And I want to help you redefine that. Next, another secret. This one has exposed a series of dark sexual events, and they're threatening to destroy one young family. We'll be right back.